Hello, everybody, and welcome to The Jank Tank. I'm your host, Amy the Amazonian, and today we're going to be playing a deck that is the greatest of all time. I'd like to say thank you to Channel Fireball for making this video possible, and also I want to let all of you know that there is a new spoiler page at CFB. That's right, if you go to channelfireball.com/spoilers, there is a snazzy gallery that will show you all of the spoilers from Zendikar Rising. So if you want to keep up to date with the newest cards that have been revealed, you should check it out. Now, when I said this deck was the greatest of all time, what I should have said is this deck is a goat. Also, it has a goat in it. There's not that many goats in Magic. I'm sorry to all you Goat Napper fans out there. But there are a few, and this deck runs four of them. That's right, we've got four copies of the Stormwild Caprador. That is the key part of this deck. I have it called Self-Flagellation. You'll hear other people call this deck Stop Hitting Yourself and various other forms of... Oops, I'm hurting my own creatures, but it's okay because that's good for my deck. So this deck is really based around the combination of Marauding Raptor and Stormwild Caprador. Those were the two cards that I started with, and it really grew from there. There's a bunch of cards that you might expect to see in this deck, like Brash Taunter, and there it is. And then there's other cards which I don't run, like the True Fire Captain. There she is. The True Fire Captain also has this clause here. If it's dealt damage, it deals damage to a player. I chose not to include this card just because I found in my testing it was too hard to cast and a little too easy to kill. Similarly with Hactos, this deck does have these four Marauding Raptors, which means that when a creature enters the battlefield, you end up dealing 2 damage to it, assuming a raptor is out. That is amazing for the Stormwild Caprador, because not only does the raptor make the Caprador take 2 damage, which makes it get +2/+2, that's what the Caprador does, by the way. If you deal non-combat damage to it, that includes fight damage, you end up getting a bigger Caprador and preventing the damage. This does not apply to redirected damage, which is important, because this deck also runs Gideon's Sacrifice, which redirects damage. It does not prevent damage. But again, Marauding Raptor, really wonderful card. It's this pseudo ramp, also kind of gives you an advantage with creatures in this deck. I do run 2 copies of Bossier's Lieutenant in here, which notably does not die to Marauding Raptor or 2 Marauding Raptors as long as you choose to put the +1/+1 counter from Bossier's Lieutenant onto itself. I just really like this deck. It's got a lot of damage-based board wipes. You've got cards like Response Resurgence, which not everybody thinks about, but Response Resurgence means, hey, I attack in with my Stormwild Caprador, I deal 5 damage to it, it gets +5/+5. You can definitely close out games with this card, and it's amazing when it happens. And I can't wait for you guys to see how this deck works. There's a couple fun-ofs in here. I've got Go for Blood. I mentioned before, fight damage does beef up that Caprador. I've also got 1 Gideon Blackblade because doesn't die Marauding Raptor. Great card. Survives all these board wipes. It's super fun to play. Probably the card that makes this deck the saddest is number 1, Ugin, because you exile my cards and I can't stop you. And the other one is, unfortunately being run by a lot of people. It's Bone Crusher Giant. Because damage can't be prevented this turn if you cast Stomp. And sometimes that means that my poor Caprador dies during my board wipes. It's so sad. So let's just hop right into the queue with this deck. So I'm going to go ahead and say, Self-Flagellation, let's take you to Ranked. I did build a sideboard for this deck, by the way. I am not going to be utilizing it, but if you're interested in what you could put into a sideboard for this deck, it is on the deck list, which should be in the description below. Who's our first opponent? The Fish Song? Okay, Fish Song, I hope you're ready for a bright and early Marauding Raptor. I get to scry on turn 1 because this deck does not do anything on turn 1. And I'm going to be looking for a Caprador or Bossier's Lieutenant, because Bossier's Lieutenant will only cost 3 mana if I've got a Marauding Raptor out. This deck being so heavy on these damage-based board wipes and damage-based removals is also fantastic because it means that early threats don't really bother me. go for blood. Well, I could cycle that, but I'm not interested. I don't think that my opponent is going to be tossing down any critters right away. And my little puppy pet sleeve. Oh, it's so cute. I love this dog. I bought the Mastery Pass only for this dog. I waited until I had enough levels to unlock this dog. And I was like, yep, that's worth my money. Hello there, puppy. I wish I could touch your tummy. Oh my god, they finally played a card. It's Island. Great. You better flash in a Spectral Sailor. Come on, I'm waiting. Where's the sailor? There it is! Called it! Knew it was going to happen. Either that, it was going to be Opt, or just a very disappointing start from the Fish Song. Oh, it's a blue-red deck? This might be an Is It Flash variant. I am going to go ahead and play this Plains here, and that is because Flame Sweep, though it wouldn't hit my flyers, does hit their flyers, and if they end up throwing a few more little birds out here, I want to be ready for it. It's possible that they could flash in something like Threnody Singer. They still wouldn't be able to kill my Raptor this turn, but it's better to be ready. Now I'm waiting. Let's see if they throw down a 2-drop that has perhaps 2 toughness or less. And because this does look like the sort of deck that might run counterspells, if they... Nice. If they play something, I'm not going to try and play around it while they have much mana up. I feel okay about them having 2 mana up. I feel like I could have Scorching Dragonfired that last turn. It may have been a mistake not to. I'm not going to save the Flame Sweep for a couple more targets. Ah, it's a Quench. All right, so they will get to draw their card this turn, but now they only have 1 blue mana up, and I feel very safe to Flame Sweep. Oh, hey, Gideon. Sorry, boy, you are not coming out right now. We're sweeping. I should have actually waited until my end step, because there's a good chance that they're going to flash something else out, like another Sailor, or never mind, they have nothing. And we win. Great work, Capridor.deck. We didn't even see the Capridors that time, but I did get a turn 2 Raptor, so I'm happy about that. Give myself a Poliwag symbiote. Hello there, Poliwag. Something I want to also mention about this deck is I'm running Deafening Clarions and Storm's Wraths. At some point, I did also have Justice Strike in this deck for single target removal. And I also had, what's it called? Solar Blaze? It's the 4 mana Justice Strike for everything. And it was in this deck up until I found Yikes. This is not killing enough things that I want to be killing. It kills things like Uro and Kroxa, which is wonderful, but it doesn't hit the Titans. And I kept this hand because it does have early removal in this Scorching Dragonfire in response, as well as a Scryland, so I can hopefully get to the creatures that I need. Hello there, Runaway Steamkin. I wonder if I'll need to light you on fire. This card, by the way, is great. It's one of the few removal pieces that burns and also, well, also takes out planeswalkers. That's important to me. So I did not Scorching Dragonfire to Steamkin here because I want to use it on Anax, and that's because Anax is best exiled. I could have exiled the Steamkin. They wouldn't have gotten the on death proc for Anax, but I felt like I have response in hand. I can take this out, and I don't mind taking all of 2 damage while it has only 1/+1/+1 counter on it. So now they're swinging in. I doubt they'll be able to make use of any mana or the Steamkin's abilities. It's dead. Unless they have Fling, in which case it's dead, but then they get to deal a whole 2 damage to my face, and I doubt they're running Fling. Nobody does that anymore, except for the occasional adventure deck. Those are, by the way, the Brave decks. Oh, wait a minute. They're trying something. They have given their Steamkin +3/+2, which also gave it an additional +1/+1 counter. They're giving another +1/+1 counter with Rimrock Knight. This is the full aggro turn. Look at this. Now, what I really hope they do is, yes, they're dealing 9 damage to me. That's very sad. Oh no, boo-hoo. I hope that they kill their Steamkin by trying to cast something else that costs more than 1 mana this turn. Maybe it'll be worth it to them. I have a Storm's Wrath, so this isn't going to survive either way. But if they take those +1/+1 counters off it, as they did, it's dead. Goodbye. I'll see you later. I don't like being at 9 life. That was a lot of stuff on that Steamkin. Shouldn't have underestimated the fact that Infuriate exists. Oh, I'm being stepped on. Well, that's one stomp I don't have to worry about later. And I really don't want to take 3. So I'm going to go ahead and Storm's Wrath right here. I've got Brash Taunter ready for next turn. And the turn after that, Gideon Sacrifice in case they're trying to redirect damage. Oh, that would have been a really nice card to have. But here we go. It's the Taunter. Taunter is indestructible. If you've never seen this card, you're missing out. It is a 5-mana 1/1 goblin. And if anybody is running -X/-X effects, well, let's think for whoever has the goblin. But right now, like, I'm happy. I'm sitting here. If I've got mana left over, I could just swing out one of those. Oh, Tin Street Cadet. That is an arena exclusive card. And also, I don't really care that they have it. Because I'm doing this. Bye, nerds. And now I am left with a choice. Do I swing in, gain 1 life? Or do I sit here and hold back my fight ability? I'm going to be doing that. I'm going to be holding back the fight ability and going on the offensive. Yeah, I know. It's weird. It's more offensive for me to keep this back and not fight. Don't question it. This already has a fight ability built in. They didn't play a creature, so I'm going to go ahead and cycle. And I got Gideon. We got Gideon. We've got a sacrifice. You want to watch this guy die? Great. You're in a great place for it, because I doubt Gideon is going to survive if this game is not won in a few turns. I'm going to give Brash Taunter Vigilance, because I don't think anything else is very useful. Swing in. It's still being held up as a blocker. And I have that fight ability. Hello there, Tin Street Cadet. This is a strange card for you to be running, but I look forward to fighting it. Gorgeous. Really just makes a girl happy to see. Oh, a Caprador showed up! Finally, a Caprador! Go ahead and give that bad boy Vigilance. And now my opponent does not even need to play a card for me to fight, because I actually already have a fight target. I could fight Gideon there, and 4 damage would be dealt to my opponent. What's nice is the damage gets prevented. But I really love fighting my own Caprador and dealing the damage to it, which gets prevented and turned into a +1/+1 counter. But never mind, we don't even get to go further in that game, because we're winning. Because this deck is the GOAT. I'm telling you, you should not underestimate this type of deck. It performs fairly well in Best of One. I know in the like first Jank Tank episode, I went hard on the Jank and less on the, let's say, strength of the deck. This is an off-meta deck that kicks butt, especially when you're up in a meta where so many people are trying to play very aggressively. Mono Green Stompy, if they don't get their tramplers down, oftentimes falls prey to this deck, because you end up sitting there with a Caprador that's bigger than their biggest creature, things that died of damage-based wipes. It feels good to play. So unfortunately, this hand has a board wipe, it's got some creatures, it's got a scry, but it doesn't have enough for me. So I'm gonna keep this hand instead. We've got this Dragonfire, which I could use to beef up my Caprador, but I'm probably going to need it to destroy that Knight of Ebon Legion instead. I can get Caprador down with the Marauding Raptor, but this card is scary. I'm trying to think, like, if I want to do this turn, I'd want to do it now while they don't have mana up, before they can pump this card. If I play Marauding Raptor, I might be stopping them from attacking with the Fervent Champion. I might not be. On turn three, no matter what, I can't Caprador and Scorching Dragonfire. So I think I'm making the right choice by doing this right now. I'm going to just get rid of the Knight of Ebon Legion. Unfortunately, Death Touch does get rid of these friends. Oh, Stormfist Crusader! That is going to be giving us both card draw. That's a fun little piece of work. I feel like going for the Marauding Raptor first. I don't think I need the Caprador yet. And I'd rather get it buffed when I do get to play it. One of these critters can't even be dealt with. Whoa, they shocked in four. Oh, it's Reggie! Hey there, Reggie. They didn't attack in with these because they knew I could kill one. So it's time for the Caprador. I've got two different lands I can give some consideration to here. I'm going to go with the Temple of Triumph because I have another land that allows me to take out Rotting Regisaur. I did throw the Marauding Raptor to the bottom there. That was a... Oh, look at that. Actually, I wish you had extra white mana. I did throw that to the bottom. A lot of that was just... I know it's not going to be super useful right now. I really want a board wipe rather than these single piece removals. And what's going to really, really make this hard is I gotta chump block this. I'm going to throw one Fervent Champion as a blocked card, but I'm pretty sure they have Embercleave and that I've actually already lost this game. Oh, no, it is Black Lance Paragon giving this Death Touch. Goodbye, Caprador, and goodbye, Raptor. So now I really, really need... That's not a board wipe. It's not a board wipe, but I can actually survive here. And I think it's worth showing off how I survive. I'm going to play Bastard's Lieutenant. Put the +1/+1 counter on itself. It's now a 4/5. If they have an Embercleave, I've lost this. If they don't, I think I'm okay. Ouch. And that's because I can use Gideon's Sacrifice to redirect damage and live a turn. That's just a Regisaur. I don't care about that. I have no board wipes left in this deck. The one that I mentioned earlier that has things deal damage based in power. That one's gone. So I can kill one of these in blocking though. And I'm going to choose to kill eeny, meeny, miny you. I do live this turn, unless this is an Embercleave, which it might be. I always fear the Embercleave. Oh, that's fine. A lot of people think that this is damage prevention. It's not, it's damage redirection. So like if a creature with Death Touch gets redirected, then the damage just moves on to that creature. The only damage that did get prevented was from Stormfist Crusader, because this has protection from multicolored. Right, so that board wipe that has damage from power would be great here. But I don't have it. And that's a real bummer. So let's see, they've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Oof. I don't think I can get out of this. It's like I can play the Marauding Raptor. That gives me a blocker and this. Then I'm chump blocking the Regisaurs. I could take out one Regisaur with Elspeth Conqueror's Death. That's not really enough to do anything. Oh, why are you holding priority? Just based on the number of attackers they have, I feel like I'm dead. Drill bit. Okay, yep. Bye. I'm still dead. Like, they just use these two Fervent Champions. They buff off each other. Good game. There we go. Done. Dead. A great match. And it's really nice to see knights getting played here because it's such a good deck. And it's a deck that has like all these Eldraine cards that don't need a ton of support from other sets. Rotting Regisaur, I know it's not a knight, it's an honorary knight. It's rotating. Doesn't matter. Most of this deck sticks around and it's super duper fun. All right, so let's hop right back into the queue with Self-Flagellation. Get some good games in here. I like seeing all these different decks. It's a lot better than, all right, well, it's Sultai ramp. Joy, what's your end game? Ugin? Thrilling. Oh, it's the Bitter Blossom sleeves. They're pretty. Okay. Turn one. Mountain. Notably, I do want more white mana than red mana when I'm playing this deck. But if I played the Plains there, it was going to hold priority for Gideon's Sacrifice, and I just don't like it when it does that. So if I can get this early Bossier's Lieutenant done, that would be great. With Bossier's Lieutenant, you are given the choice of putting the +1/+1 counter on the Raptor or the Lieutenant. This choice is going to be based in, do I have a Storm's Wrath? If no, put it on the Raptor. Or if I have two Raptors, I have to put it on the Lieutenant. The reasoning for that is because a Storm's Wrath, I can survive with Bossier's Lieutenant if I have put the +1/+1 counter on this card. Otherwise, if they find a way to kill my Lieutenant when it has the +1/+1 counter on it and the Raptor survives, the Raptor deals 2 damage to the Knight when it enters the battlefield, and well, then I just feel really stupid. So I like to put it on the Raptor a lot of the time. Bossier's Lieutenant, notable in this matchup, as protection from multicolored. And I believe this is Teemer Adventures, which does run Uro in most of the lists I've seen, just because it's a good card. It's like, if you're in green and blue, you run Uro, because why wouldn't you run Uro? It's good. I'm sure there's like a flash deck or a control deck that doesn't run it that I just haven't matched up against. Ooh, okay. Here comes the double Brazen Borrower card that can be very tough against this deck, especially if we have a Capridor we're trying to beef up. I have the option here of, do I want to play the Raptor or do I want to play the Lieutenant? I'm just going to go for the Lieutenant. There it is. Puts a +1/+1 counter on itself. It's a 4/5. I'm going to slurp loudly from my beverage and drink it using my Void Straw. I love magic so much, I drink it. That's right. I've got a straw that gets green screened out. The Void Straw. It's good. Good straw. Lovestruck Beast coming down. It's a 5/5. Lovely friends you got there. You keep great company. I'm just feeling tricky here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to swing in. What's up? You want to trade? Nope. So they know I have Castle Emberth, and I've got Castle Emberth and mana up right here. So they were smart and did not block, because trading that with the beast and then I still get a 2/2, that just feels like a bad trade on their part. Also, bonus, they're at 11, because they've shocked in some lands, and I'm sitting pretty. I've gotten to hit them. 4/5, has vigilance, I get the block too. And I do not mind double blocking. If they swing in with the beast, I can use Gideon's Sacrifice on whichever thing they try to assign damage to first and redirect it onto the other one just to kill it if it's something I don't want dying. Like, I can force the Marauding Raptor to die. Poor baby. Poor baby Raptor. It deserves better than this, being used as the sacrifice. Oh, they get to draw a card. This is actually a card I haven't seen in this deck before. I mean, it's a nice addition. Giving this trample, that's strong. Giving the Beanstalk Giant, that's what's going to get trampled. That's going to be huge. Oh, what's this? They're stepping. I'm going to let the first half of that resolve. I'm going to redirect the damage from the second one onto Lieutenant. Sup? Yeah, you didn't expect that one, did you? I still have my critters, and they're swinging in with everything? Nope, they're not swinging in with Rachel and her best friend Rachel. I'm just going to take 5. Oh, and this is the thing I was talking about. The knight, it dies! Because the effect from the sacrifice was still live. Nah, it didn't really matter if I blocked or not there. Let's see, I've got a fight spell here, but I feel like I could use something more than a fight spell. I just want to cycle that. I'm going to go for a swing. Probably could have waited for them to block. You got a text message in the middle of this recording. Great! I've responded to the text message. I'm being a responsible content creator and only being kind of distracted and misplaying. Me misplay during recordings? Oh, well, I would never. Interestingly, if I didn't activate Castle Embereth, I could have fought that 1-1 and prevented them from attacking in with the Lovestruck Beast. Because he would have been so lonely. Boo-hoo-hoo. Alright, well, never mind. They would have had all the Rachels in the world. So I'm gonna just go ahead and cycle this. I'm gonna look for, I don't know, maybe a damage-based board wipe. Okay, Brash Taunter, that's pretty nice. Stinks that they have Trample on everything, but still having a reusable blocker that can fight these fools. I want you to commit to the board everything. Dang, that is some nice tech, though. Keep this dude in mind. You see this fellow, Death Muffin? I want everybody here to look at what they're doing and say, ha dang, you got some sweet, sweet tech. Let me at that. Because they got some sweet, sweet tech. Let me at that. Can we give him Lovestruck Beast Trample? Drawing cards? Now that I think of it, Brazen Borrower is like the only big creature in this deck that doesn't trigger it, and it doesn't really matter because Petty Theft is already so powerful. And that ain't a big critter. That's a Fae of Wishes. They're about to dig through their sideboard and find something powerful. Like their style. They're pretty parallax style. Frogify. Oh no, you are not turning my Taunter into a frog. Well, I suppose they are going to turn it into a frog. I don't think I have a way to come back from this. They're getting so much value out of Gurek's Uprising. This is about to be a frog. Oh, that's lifelink too. Yikes. Super duper yikes. There's the Frogify. Double block a Bone Crusher Giant. That doesn't feel like enough. That doesn't feel like enough. I'm gonna give it one more turn. Ow. Also, maybe I'll jokingly activate Castle Arnaville only to watch the token get killed by the raptor. My sweet, sweet raptor. Here comes Shadow Spear. And I did not draw anything useful, so I'm going to just scooch on out of here. Defeated? Me? Never! Let's go into the next one. I might be hard in denial about this deck. Sure, me and the guy from the Mountain Goats think that it's the best deck ever, but maybe we're wrong. Just kidding, it's the best deck ever. It's so fun to play this deck. It feels like just the right level of tricky. It's not completely linear, which is fun. And it's got a different playstyle than most other decks. This is Fine. I'm going to keep this hand and just hope that I'm able to scry to something that is maybe raptor-like or Capradora-like. Got removal. What is this going to be? Is it spells? No, looks like teamer to me. That would come in tapped. There we go. And they are looking for land. So this is another adventure deck. Here's an Edgewall Innkeeper. I'm just going to go ahead and get rid of that friend in case there's something I want to actually play on turn three. And I didn't actually get anything to play in turn three. This is their card draw engine that I usually see in these decks. Unlike that last one that was like Gurik's Uprising, fight me. Okay, ouch. This is going to deal 2 damage to me, but I'm going to go ahead and say hashtag worth. How about I get a card I can play on this turn? No? I'm gonna cycle. I have the Brash Taunter next turn. These are not the cards I'm looking for. I play some things with one toughness. No? You only got that? They probably have some Brazen Borrowers. Let's find out! Oh no, no Brazen Borrower. Or either that or I accidentally passed their turn, which totally happens. I've done that before. Beans, 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 beans. They played a big old bean boy and he does not have trample. I'm just gonna go ahead and play a second one of these. I'm not gonna attack in. Monster Surgence is better with the Capador. It is 5 damage with the Taunter, but I'm going to be using my mana to fight. Yeah, that's 2 life they get. There's Edgewall Innkeeper. Oh my god, he's a 2-2! Eddie, no! Love Strike Beast. You're not going to make a 1-1? You should attack me. You should attack me with the Beanstalk Giant. You should really attack me with that Beanstalk Giant. So right now, I have 16 damage on the battlefield. And I'm just gonna sit here and chill. They play more lands. I might get the lethal. I also might draw Brazen Borrower, which would make me very sad. They're digging. You know what? That's probably why they didn't make any Rachels before. They're digging. Yes, again, this is Rachel, the 1-1 human. Some people call her Belle because it's Beauty and the Beast. Oh, there's another Clover. If they attack in without borrowing, all right. Nice! And they're out of there because they were dead next turn. GG. Trample's very important. Let it be known, trample's very important. I've got time for one more game with this deck because it is so fun. So I hope it's a good one. Amazonian versus Rafoli. All right, Mr. Luca. I hope you like to look at this. It's my deck. Look at it. Things I should be doing right now. Preparing to commentate the Mythic Invitational. Things I am doing right now. Playing my goat. It's a bird goat. Half of the time it makes a bird noise, half of the time it makes a goat noise. That's not a joke, that's actually what happens in the game. There are different sound effects assigned to different creature types. And some of them get really funny because they're like cat, creature type cat. And that includes Leonin, which are like the cat people, and also house cats, and also lions. So sometimes you'll play a lion, it will be like, meow. They fixed it for some cards, like Bronzehide Lion, I believe, does roar when it enters the battlefield. But it's funnier when it doesn't. Oh, you don't have a land. I can Clarion, but I can't redirect the damage. I get Scorching Dragonfire. I think that sounds actually pretty good right now, so I'm just going to go ahead and do that. I could also, Bossu's Lieutenant, put the +1/+1 counter on that Raptor. And go ahead and go for the throat. Wait, that's a different card. Timuramp. That's what we're up against here. Their endgame is Ugin's and Nissa's. Probably. I don't actually know that for sure. I'm just guessing. I kind of want to cycle. And swing in. I'm going to response my Capridor here because that gives it a permanent +5/+5 buff. Unfortunately, Go for Blood does not, if I did have 2 mana, it does not allow you to fight 2 creatures you have against each other, or I would use it to make Capridors fight Capridors. Oh, hello there, Vivian, Monsters Advocate. What's the worst you can do, huh? Make a beast and give it reach? That's funny. That's funny because it doesn't work. I have many ways that I could win this round. I could Deafening Clarion, but I could also just show you what happens when you fight with damage prevention here. Get +3/+3. And that is victory. And now you have seen my goat. And I think that you should try this deck out. Hopefully this gameplay has convinced you that this is some jank worth trying. And if it hasn't, oh, then I need to try harder. Thank you again so much for watching, and also thank you for sponsoring this video channel, Fireball. It is wonderful to get to make content for you, and I hope that people continue to watch this. If you ever want to watch my content live, by the way, I stream at twitch.tv/Amazonian virtually every day, so you should check it out and come hang with me. See you during the next time we take a dive into the Jank Tank.